Now, in our first story, government has urged the country's public service to up their game in their service delivery. Speaking as this year's Africa Public Service Day commemoration to recognize the values and virtues of the public servant, Deputy Chief of Staff Samuel Abu-Jinapor noted that the vision of the new dawn cannot be attained unless the public servant rises up to the challenge.
Broken public service is a broken country. This conventional wisdom, Mr. Chairman, was never lost on the Constituent Assembly, which pieced together the 1992 Constitution, as they found it prudent to dedicate the entire Chapter 14 of our National Constitution to the public services of Ghana. The framers of this Constitution, in their wisdom, defined the public services of Ghana. They spelled out in detail the appointment processes of the officers of this service. They comprehensively set out the functions of this service. Therefore, the importance of the public services of our country to the social, political, and economic aspirations of our countrymen and women is beyond doubt. Mr. Chairman, to appreciate the important role that the presidency, and for that matter, the Office of the Chief of Staff, plays in the functioning of the public service of our country, it is imperative to carefully examine Article 195 of the 1992 Constitution, and with your kind permission, I wish to reproduce it. Chairman, Article 195 clause 1, and I quote, "Subject to the provisions of this Constitution, the power to appoint persons to hold or to act in an office in the public services shall vest in the President. Acting in accordance with the advice of the Governing Council of the service concerned, given in consultation with the Public Services Commission." Clause 2, significantly, states, "The President may, subject to such conditions as he may think fit, delegate some of his functions under this article by directions in writing to the Governing Council concerned, or to a committee of the Council, or to any member of that Governing Council, or to any public officer," end quote. Togwe Chairman, from the above, it is obvious that the office of the President is cardinal in the functioning of our public service. It is from the foregoing that the Honorable Chief of Staff, Akosua Frema Osei Opare, has instructed me to send her extraordinary solidarity to this gathering.
Deputy Chief of Staff Samuel Abu-Jinapor there. Now, this year's theme is entrenching a citizen-centered service delivery culture, partnering the youth for African transformation. Head of the local government service, Nana Ato Arthur, also had this to say.
"Today, people's expectations are very, very high. And as such, it calls for dedicated, loyal, efficient, effective, and professional civil and public servants. And the youth must be encouraged to play an active role in entrenching a citizen-centered service delivery for Africa's transformation. I must say that I totally agree to the transformation of Africa, but without sounding selfish, Ghana needs to be transformed first. By this, we must all be committed to the transformation of our 216 metro, municipal, and district assemblies. After all, the 216 MMDs constitute Ghana. So when the MMDs are transformed, Ghana is transformed. That's what I believe in. At this juncture, since today is dedicated to Mr. Nathan Kwao, let me throw out a suggestion. If it's not already conceived by you, Head of Civil Service, closer. I feel that in addition to what we are witnessing today, it will be a fitting tribute to this gallant Ghanaian if his writings, memoirs, and moderating administrative circulars could be collated and published in a book so that his whole host of admirers may have the privilege of keeping in material form his memory, which they cherish so dearly. On this occasion, of the celebration of Africa Public Service Day, we salute the public services of Ghana and hope they will continue to give their best to Mother Ghana.
Nana Atuata there, the head of the local government service. Now, former President Jerry John Rawlings is expected to speak at that program to commemorate the Africa Public Service Day. Stay with us. We'll take you live to the program as soon as he comes. But in the meantime, let's go to the Ashanti region, because a Kumasi-based businessman is fighting back accusations that he owes the Ghana Revenue Authority over 7 million Ghana cedis in outstanding taxes. Rice importer Roxin Kofi Nsia is one of eight persons who is said to have defaulted payment of taxes to a tune of over 11 million Ghana cedis in the Ashanti region. This follows Ghana Revenue Authority's special revenue mobilization drive by a special task force to recover the huge debt. Prince Apia reports.
The Ghana Revenue Authority embarked on an operation in Kumasi on Thursday to compel the indebted companies to pay up. It comes 8 months after GRA officials say the companies had failed to respond to demand notices. However, Mr. Nsia's supervisor, Michael Nati, who was present at the time the special tax force visited the company premises, disagrees. He tells journalists he will contest the GRA in court because the company does not owe the amount quoted by the revenue agency.
For 7 million and something amount, please, my brothers, what business will a person do in Ghana here? What the profit? Is it three times that amount? And we'll be able to really contest the figure that they have quoted. It's not up to this amount.
How much do you owe them?
For the records are not currently available, but we did provide them with our correct statement of account. And mind you, the government of Ghana, the previous government of Ghana, brought a ban on importation of rice. During that period, that was 2013-2014, we weren't working. But they managed to get some figures that they used in their calculation. But their figures that they brought to us contains that period that the ban was. So we have a lot of things that we'll be able to engage them. The amount that is stated on this document is not what we owe per our records. We don't owe them, because what they brought, our records, we submit our VAT returns to them. They brought their statement to us. We went through the VAT returns that we did provide them, the figures that they do use. It wasn't what we provide them. So we will be able to contest with them the figures that they have quoted that arrive at that 737 million Ghana.
What do you mean? How do you contest?
Please, Ghana, yes, we have legal, yes. They are doing their work.
The tax force locked up defaulting businesses who have 14 days grace period to redeem their tax obligations or face sanctions. Coordinator of the Special Tax Force, Henry Sam, says defaulters will have their property sold to defray their debt or be dragged to court.
The Kofinse was tax audited by our Swami, MTU. He raised issues to object to the examination of accounts using the financial statements. And in consonance with the law, if you go to section 42B, 5B of the Revenue Administration Act, the same law that grants you the opportunity to object also indicates that before your objection is heard, you should pay 30% pending the determination of the objection. We sent a notice to that effect to remind the company to effect payment of the down payment of the amount that is supposed to be paid, that is 30%. The company did not pay. We also sent a reminder. I have copies of all of them. No payment was made of the 30%. So therefore, we take it that we have to recover the amount, the full amount, due in respect of the tax, interest, and penalties.
I know you went to the defaulters.
The defaulters have 14 days grace period, within which they have to extinguish the tax. Failure to do so, the law will apply. We have to value their property and then sell them to defray the outstanding tax.
Prince Apia reporting.
The region, because the annual general NPP delegate conference currently underway in the Subin constituency in the Ashanti region has degenerated into a trading of blows. well-built men, popularly known as macho men, were positioned to issue special accreditation for entry while manning the gates for today's conference. The Subin constituency chairman, Amankwa, was denied entry on his arrival at the gates. Let's go straight to the phone lines and speak with my colleague Erastus Asaridonko, live with the latest. Now, Erastus, what caused the exchange of blows?
Well, it was supposed to be an annual delegates conference that will be highlighting what the constituency is going through at the moment, activities, plans of the MP and all that. And per the constitution, as quoted by the communications director for the constituency, it was supposed to be held and sanctioned by chairman of the constituency, Chairman Amankwa, but he claims he was not consulted, and so they were not aware of the even the venue for the program this morning. And so he decided upon hearing it that he will still grace the occasion with his presence, or else constitutionally the conference will not have been valid. Then when he came in, the well-built men were already at the gate. They were inspecting special accreditation before they allow you in. And they said he did not have accreditation, so they won't allow him in. And so his followers and the fiscally built men started exchanging blows, insults here and there, verbal accusations and all that. And so they started trading blows in front of the police at the gate, and they were not allowing anybody to enter the hall. And so it created quite a commotion, a confusion for about 15 minutes before the police were able to calm things down and allow the chairman to enter, which of course quelled all the violence. So currently, as we speak, the conference has started. The MP has also been reacting to what happened. He claims that there's a lot of misconception about him and what he does and what happens at the constituency level, and he will not allow any individual person to spoil the peace that is reigning in the constituency. If anybody do not understand anything, they should come to him. They should not be resorting to insults and trading of accusations and all that. As well, currently, there are people who support the chairman who are outside the conference hall. There are some who are in there, and the program is going on correctly. But they are still not allowing those without accreditation to enter the hall.
Now, these people who are outside the auditorium at the moment, are they delegates of the MPP?
Well, some claim they are delegates, but they do not—they were not consulted. They do not have accreditation, and so they are not being allowed in. Others also claim that they are not delegates, and so they must remain outside. So that's the deal at the moment.
Now, you were saying earlier that it's the chairman who is supposed to sanction meetings like this, but he just heard of it and he was attending. Have we been able to gather who called for this meeting and who issued this special accreditation?
Well, I learned that it was the MP who issued the special accreditation. It was him together with the other executives of the party who organized this conference. The chairman claims he had no knowledge of it, and he had requested that the conference be held earlier than today, which it was rejected. And so he did not know that the conference will be held today as we are speaking. And so there is a vice chairman who is also in there, who is part of the executives who organized this whole conference. So he is claiming that he was not consulted. He has been sidelined. There are factions within the constituency. Now it has been reduced to him and the former MP, and is breeding tension within the constituency. But the MP says nothing is happening. Everything is going on well. He will continue to ensure that things are done as it is. The constituency is the one that is going to benefit, not individuals.
So are there any security personnel in sight?
Quite a number of policemen here, armed policemen. I can count about six currently stationed here, but they did not effect any arrests. They were just trying to calm tension down, asking them to calm down and allowing certain people to go in and restraining other people as well. So that is what they've been doing at the moment.
Thank you very much, Erastus Asaridonko, bringing us that report there from Subin constituency in Kumasi. Now, the Data Protection Commission is today embarking on an exercise with officers of the Ghana Police Service to arrest directors of companies who have failed to register with the commission. Head of Cyber Unit as the police CID, Dr. Gustav Janssen, told the press engagement with data controllers haven't yielded much, hence the need for the arrest. Joy News' Joseph Akable is with the team embarking on this exercise and joins us on the phone with details. Hi, Joseph. The exercise began as the Osu branch of Koala. What's the progress of the exercise so far?
Well, Daniel, just a short while ago, we just moved from the Marina Mall, as it's called, but known officially as the Marina Market Ghana Limited. Now, what happened when we headed first to Koala is that it was realized that the branch that we had visited was not the main branch itself. So we have to move over to the main headquarters where we expected to find a director for the company. So that is where the team is heading. But at the Marina Mall where we visited, the team of the CID officers as well as officials from the Ghana Data Commission, upon entry, they were handed a document that indicated that the company had just initiated the process of registering with the Data Commission. Now, the process is that you fill a form online, you print out the form, and you are required to make payment to the commission within 2 weeks. Now, that notwithstanding, they still handed the director of the company an invitation to the CID office within 24 hours. Failure to do so will mean that the CID will have to move in and effect the arrest and take them over to the offices of the CID for interrogation.
Does that mean that today's exercise is not to arrest anyone but to invite them to the CID for questioning?
It is all in line with the arrest itself. I mean, they have first invite them voluntarily to show up for interrogation. And if you fail to do so, that is when they have to forcibly effect the arrest. And so it is all part of the process. That is why they are starting in this regard. So we are expecting to visit quite a number of companies that, for obvious reasons, we may not want to put out there to put them on alert as the team is moving towards that side now.
Right. Thank you very much, Joseph Akable, for that report. We'll be going back to find out the latest from this crackdown by the Data Protection Commission later in the day. You're still watching Joy News Today. Now, the attention of Ghana and other neighboring countries has been drawn to the outbreak in Liberia, which has killed at least 11 persons. In an alert letter to the Ghana Health Service, health officials were advised to increase the level of disease surveillance and infection prevention protocols. Though the threat of the disease seems to have subsided in Liberia, the Ghana Health Service says the surveillance protocols that it set up are still on high alert to prevent any such outbreak in the country. We'll be bringing you details of this particular story after this short break. Still watching Joy News Today. Now, girls are taught that their place is in the kitchen and they have to be subordinate to men. Some are even told that education is the preserve of men and not women. Well, some NGOs have teamed up to fight against these perceptions. The Girls Education Network says its work will support the Girls Education Unit of the Ghana Education Service. The network has just been launched in Accra.
Across the country are vulnerable. That's the position of this network of NGOs. The regional coordinator of Girls Education Network, Madam Christiana, says the initiative must change the state of affairs.
The inspiration for this initiative is about the promotion of girls' education. We know that education cannot be left in the hands of an individual or just the government. So as a regional girls' education officer, we do a lot of activities for the girls in terms of sensitizing them to be assertive and also to stay in school, and also their parents to send their girls to school, and not just taking them to school, but to support them to be able to have the peace of mind to study and achieve.
Former Deputy Tourism Minister Jifa Gumashi said there is the need to empower girls with good education.
It's a dream come true. The originator, Auntie Christie, and I have been working together for almost 10 years when she was the head of the Queen of Peace Catholic School in Medina. And she's always been very passionate about things that she can do to improve the girl child's educational period when she's with the teachers. And to see that finally her dream has come true, I'm really, really, really very happy to see this happen. And to see that she has this idea and has been able to bring together people with like minds is the way in which it will become sustainable. Is when you have people share in your dream that your dream can materialize. If the girl child is well equipped, her children ultimately are the beneficiaries.
Deputy Education Minister Benis Ofori, in an interview with Joy News, said the Girls Education Network will complement the work of the Girls Education Unit of the GEAs.
We are interested in bringing all the NGOs together so that we will pull resources together and be able to spread it evenly to every hook and cranny of the region where they are support are needed. So we saw that so many NGOs are spread all over, but sometimes some are concentrated in a particular area. So as a region, we saw the need of getting them to know one another so that we coordinate them better. And then those with special expertise go to places where they are needed so that some areas will not be left out in the support of the girl child in the region.
For some participants, even more vulnerable are disabled girls.
A very laudable program, because this gen is I think it's a network of NGOs, whereby NGOs are going to interact and also share ideas and help each other to move forward. I think we all have a common goal, and for that reason, it's going to help us a lot and also going to strengthen us, especially we having one of our objectives as a to empower girls. The bottom line of this network is to empower girls. Now we have our slogan, our girls, our future. We want to strengthen the future of our girls. So I think this network is going to go a long way to strengthen NGOs who are part of the initiative.
Girls on the brink must be girls on the rise.
Now the attention of Ghana, you're still watching the Joy News Today here on Joy News on Multi TV. We are taking you to the Ashanti region, and residents of Mansongkrai in the Ashanti region are accusing Asanko Mining Company of environmental pollution and neglect of local interest while operating in the area. The youth of the town have petitioned the Regional Security Council over the matter amidst rising tension. Nana Sensu Mensah followed Rexek in the Ashanti region to the site and filed this report.
The youth cite Asanko Mining for flouting environmental laws and also failing to fulfill terms of an agreement to allocate a quota of job placement to the indigenes. They say the only source of drinking water is contaminated with sodium cyanide used by the mine, while many places in the town have become flood prone due to activities of the company. Mine officials, however, dismiss allegations of cyanide pollution of water sources in the area. Operations manager Charles Amwa told Regional Minister Simon Osei-Mensah during a fact-finding visit to the mine, measures are in place to deal with potential incidents of flood.
We look at them, and those that are not correct, we let them know that it's not correct. And those that require investigation further, we do it. And then our view is to bring it to conclusion successfully, whatever allegation they put there.
Mr. Amwa also explains the company has been unable to employ the required number of skilled labor in the community because checks revealed those who were presented are not indigenous.
It will be appropriate that they come on board here for a strip proof of how we go about even our employment processes. You came here and we've shown them to you, and then you've seen it. So they must come and then we'll sit down and then we'll go through them.
Regional Minister Mr. Osei Mensah, who led the RECSEC delegation, urged company management to constantly engage all stakeholders to resolve their differences.
We have a sizable number of people that have been engaged from the community, even though the community members are still not satisfied. But we've told them to engage them, explain some of these issues to them, especially the district chief executive, who is also somebody who a native of the area, so that he can engage the community leaders and make sure that he explains some of these issues.
Right, let's now take you to the Clocksack Auditorium at Ministries, where former President Jerry John Rawlings is addressing the Africa Public Service Day celebration.
Happy birthday to you. We wish you long life. 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 May God bless you now. May God bless you now. May God bless you now.
Your Excellency, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor to have His Excellency right by me to deliver this special address and to unveil the plaque. Your Excellency.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. My apologies for not being with you at the start of the program. I was trying out some parachuting one time because my daughter Zanetta wanted to do it. And I thought, let me get a taste of it before she comes. And I went jumping on a day I shouldn't have. It had rained and I landed on my coccyx so badly. The coccyx is that large bone on your back. Very painful, even though it healed. Many years later, with a persistent sitting, it creates problem for me. So I have difficulties if I have to sit for a long time. Thank you. The testimonies that were given by those ladies and gentlemen were so, so true. And I would very much wish, I'll have a few more minutes just to say a few more things, but let's get the formality out of the way. First of all, let me say a big thank you for that cake. I mean, I feel truly privileged and honored to be part of this gathering and part of this function in memory of Mr. Nathan Kwao. I'll tell you something very interesting when I'm done. Mr. Chairman of the occasion, I hear there's a Toby. And former head of the civil service, Mr. W.K. Kemavo. Yes, sir. The chief of staff, who I believe was called away. The head of the civil service, Nana Jacob Ndwamina, the head of local government service, Nana Atu Arthur, the Clocksack Executive Secretary, Mr. Isaac Bampo Addo, members of the Clocksack, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Let me thank you, or say a big thank you to the Civil and Local Government Staff Association for once again inviting me to participate in the annual Africa yesterday somebody tried to interview me and was asking what it is like to be 70. And I said, I used to get a regular headache like everybody else. But it appears when you become 70, the headache just focuses above your right eye. And all day. And also, I think your muscles slow down, you see what I mean? And I think it's led to a slowing down of my tongue as well. So occasionally, I end up biting my tongue. So please pardon me. Ladies and gentlemen, it is particularly heartwarming that this ceremony is also recognizing the impeccable qualities of undoubtedly one of Ghana's greatest civil servants, Mr. Nathan Kwa. The theme for the Africa Public Service Day 2017, Nurturing a Culture of Professional and Ethical Values in Africa's Public Service, is very significant, especially at a time when standards have fallen, not only in the public service, but in most facets of our public and corporate institutional framework. With a membership of 43,000 drawn from the metropolitan, municipal, district assemblies, and even the Office of the President, your role cannot be overemphasized. Can you imagine what a huge solid pressure group you could constitute? And its negative or positive consequences. That responsibility must, however, go with a sincere commitment to sacrifice for your country and protect its interests at all times, however difficult the circumstances may be. Complaints about poor service delivery from your sector and other public sector related agencies are real and cannot be shoved under the carpet. Celebrations such as today's should metamorphose into durbars and workshops aimed at reinvigorating and inspiring members to embrace quality work ethic that can serve as a standard worthy of emulation by other sectors. It is quite disturbing, though, that we cannot compare the efficiency and productivity within the private corporate sector to that of the public service in our country. There are several underlying challenges with respect to funding and state investment in your sector, and that should not undermine a commitment to quality delivery. I speak of probity, accountability, and transparency, and I am convinced your sector cannot thrive if said standards are relegated to the background. Corruption, ladies and gentlemen, is not just the misappropriation of state funds. Our failure to commit to the stipulated 8 o'clock to 5 p.m. daily working period. Refusing to commit ourselves to official duties is a corrupting influence that sets the tone for significant institutional losses. Your theme of nurturing a culture of professional and ethical values in the service should confront these very core values that many have relegated to the background, so that we can restore the standards that your forebears bequeathed to you. There is no doubt that many of you are committed patriots who pursue a culture of professional and ethical values. However, there are others who abhor these standards and drag the entire public sector in the mud. We all have a responsibility to confront these negative traits and offer true meaning to the theme of your celebration. It is thus heartwarming that this auditorium is today being dedicated to the memory of one of the best public servants I've ever worked with, that's Mr. Nathan Kwa. Mr. Nathan Kwa was not a member of the PNDC or a minister in any of our governments, but he nevertheless served as a pillar of strength and quality during the time I worked with him. When Mr. Nathan Kwar was around on your side, then you knew truth was on your side. His commitment to duty and deep knowledge was faultless and unparalleled. He was results-oriented and unfazed by the personalities he worked for. He simply wanted to achieve results and serve his country with patriotic fervor. It was thus not surprising that he served various governments and never lost favor or respect at any point. There is no doubt that his years of service as a teacher contributed significantly to his quality in later years. And I wish many of our young graduates will have the opportunity to teach for a few years before they embrace all the professional challenges. Teaching exposes us to trials and hands-on experiences that serve as a store of lifelong invaluable wisdom. The former head of civil service, Alexa Glover Quarte, referred to Mr. Nathan Kwao as the walking encyclopedia of the castle. That simply sums up the quality of the man we celebrate today. In dedicating this auditorium to this patriot, let us take a cue from the high standards he exhibited throughout his career and create an avenue for the younger ones to emulate him. I implore CLOCSAC to maintain this facility to the high standard and ensure that copies of Mr. Nathan Kwao's biography are always available here so visitors to the auditorium will better appreciate why it is named after him. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chairman, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I wish you all the best in your endeavors and hope to join you again soon to deliberate on matters of national concern. Ladies and gentlemen, at a point in time, 78, it shouldn't surprise anybody that you embarked on a national strike. As the decline started, you know, under the Achampong period, and the pressure started building up, and some of us, being where we were, realized that if we didn't prepare ourselves to intervene, it could explode. And if it explodes, or if the officer corps lost their complete authority, I'm not saying I don't respect the ranks. Somebody way below could have taken it. And God help us, because of the animosity also that existed in the vertical ranks. It embarrasses me when I have to repeat something, but let me do it if you don't mind. When I'm talking about soldiers, you know, trained to be a man, to fight, goes to a market, you see what I mean? And has urine thrown at him. You can imagine the hatred that would build up inside him against the person who did that. And at the general sitting up there at the castle, whose policies and behavior and corruption has led to a situation where urine has to be poured at him. Not once, not twice, three times. On different occasions. For some of the younger ones who don't seem to understand why I had to order for Makola to be broken down. And I remember the officer was delaying. He didn't seem to smell. He couldn't smell the crave for violence in the air. And I said, have it done by the field engineers. No explosives, no tractors, no bulldozers. Give them sledgehammers to go and break down the edifice. In other words, I wanted them to exercise their anger on the structure and take it out on the people, the sellers. That's how come Makula was demolished when it was. Ladies and gentlemen, now let me go back. During that period before this thing, oh, and by the way, I'm saying it was so volatile that all it needed, you didn't need troops. No troop would have followed anybody anywhere in those days, because we were all so disenchanted with each other and angry. All it needed was somebody to strike the match and throw it into the room. If I had done that on 15th May, not many would have survived. People would just have gone berserk. This is the moment they were waiting for to punish those they thought were responsible. Even innocent officers, because an officer is an officer, you see, they think we all go to the same mess, and by extension, the hatred from up there would have come all the way down. Ladies and gentlemen, if I had ignited that thing on 15 May, June 4th, a few weeks later, would not have happened. It would have happened on that 15th May. I had to change plans, etc. Change the formula immediately, degrade it, knowing very well that what I was going to do next, I mean, could end up in our being arrested, etc. And that's what happened. In spite of that, what happened? The inevitability of June 4th because of the heat in the country then. I keep saying that somehow in the white man's country, in amongst ourselves, years ago, when the level of social responsibility was much higher, we didn't allow temperatures, pressures to build up to this extent. Somebody will be asking questions. Why is this happening? Why is this not happening? Etc., etc. But over here, when the situation becomes so corrupt and some of us are benefiting materially and others are suffering, I don't know whether it ends up looking as if we have special oxygen masks and we can't smell the gas on the ground, how the extent to which, you know, the cost of living that people are suffering. Now, No, let me take just a few minutes of your time on this issue. The point I'm trying to make is, when Kukumba people, as recently as a few years ago, decided to wage war on other ethnic groups, killings, etc., grabbing children by the feet, smashing their heads against trees, etc. What caused it? It was just over what we all know, some chicken affair, some fowl. If responsible people expected would you know, engage in this level of violence over a chicken, in effect, what does it mean? It means the temperature is not that stable. In other words, there's friction amongst the communities. Mibuada, am I lying? In other words, our lifestyle in relation to authority, the law, justice, etc., is being denied to the extent, whether in our traditional ways or in the orthodox, courthouses or the police station, people are feeling so deprived of justice that these things begin to pile up and pile up and pile up. Isn't it? And so with just that tiny little fowl, whatever it was, it blows up. And that's what I mean when I say, in a civilized society, you don't wait for the gas to fill up the room. You can smell it immediately. Hey, this thing is going on here. This negativity, this corrupt act, which is leading to this and that, should be dealt with. And that is what ensures the stability of a society, of a community. But when we do away with it, all kinds of things happen. When you look at the way rubbish was being thrown anywhere and everywhere, that is how, yeah, because the society is unable to police itself effectively anymore. Why waste my time? He's enjoying up there, having a good time. So why should I be expected to be a disciplined citizen, to be a patriot, to not engage in corruption? His form of corruption is to dump the rubbish by the roadside, on the motorway, or further, etc. When you have people who've been trained the way some of us have been trained, like the Nathan Quarles. And have power, authority, to influence, to advise, and to take the advice. Things of this nature wouldn't happen. But we've become, we don't listen anymore. We've become impervious. Ladies and gentlemen, when the situation got that tight in those days, I was also scanning around. Not what you're thinking. No, I was also scanning around for people. Oh, what's his name? Ayikuyama said the beautiful ones are not yet born. I used to have a horse many years ago at the state of Bermacom that I named the Boney. The beautiful ones are not yet born. But with time, I realized when I run into people like Justice Anand, etc., I knew the beautiful ones were there. It's just that the political space does not allow people of such integrity to get on the stage. We undermine them with money politics, etc. At Champong's time, for instance, I know some of our finest officers were just posted out all over the place, put over corporations so they can also go and tame their hands and lose their moral authority, the ethical value. You've got to understand me talking, standing and talking this way, or taking us back into history. I can't talk about this. I can't come to this man's function or your function without making reference to these things. So, it became very palpable, discernible. I don't, obviously, people could see, could hear it. You're scanning through because it's like the country was leaderless. They are there, all right, but you're looking for somebody you can respect. We're looking for somebody to lead us. Can you believe, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Nathan Quarles' name was in the air? I found out. Like scanning around, talking to a few people here and there. Mr. Nathan Quarles. That's the level of respect this man enjoyed. And I'll leave the rest. When we made our move, and I naturally have to find competent people, somebody like Justice Annan, I don't know if I ever told you how I met him. Do you want to hear it?
Yeah.
Okay. I was either in my car or on a motorbike and near the survey department going to the Air Force Mess. I met this elegant looking young lady by the roadside. And of course, I was attracted. Oh, no. No. No, you listen, though. There was something so captivating about this young lady. So I drew closer to her to have a chat with her. And she was very loosey, very polite. I took her with me to the mess. We had a drink and I sent her home. But you know, listen. I was so impressed, I'm saying, with this young lady. I was wondering who her parents are. Not her, because she was quite young. There was something quite special, which had to come from a home, Mimale. Took her home, met the mother, you know, who was behind her sewing machine. Justice Annan was in town. I left, but I had to come back later. And those days, I mean, Jazanan's name was there, Anibaita, etc. But around that time, I was in charge of the armed forces boxes. And yeah, that's so-called Yokegari story. but it's true, except that somebody got something wrong somewhere. You can ask if you want to hear it. What happened? Justice Anna, in charge of the boxing, what you call it. And we were going to stage the armed forces version of the World Military Games in Ghana. And there was another fight going to take place. I don't know whether it was Poison or whoever. And on this hot, blazing day, I went to the stadium just to go and check if seats and the rings and everything were organized properly. And there was this tall, you know, majestic looking man in his suit, in the sun, arranging the chairs himself. And I approached him. Realized and heard his name, Justice Annan. This was the man, the father of that girl I gave a lift to. Justice Annan was one of the finest, you know, judges, men I had ever come across. Mr. George Hedgeman, my wife's father. But the beauty of this combination was that Justice Annan, incidentally, was his student. How perfect. Ladies and gentlemen, June 4th happens. The giddy giddy was so giddy giddy that, there was very little you could do. But when one had to come back the second time, straight away, The beautiful ones are not yet born. No, they're born. They're there. I went fishing for them. Put them together. Let's go. Leaders. The Justice Anands, etc. Mr. Nathan Kwao. Mr. Nathan Kwao. There was something interesting that happened, young man. The one who could fetch him for me was a certain gentleman. In uniform. I didn't want to say it. But he used to work with him also at the castle in those days. And he was speaking highly of Mr. Justice Anand, his senior, etc., etc. So I said, please, go and look for him and set up your office, which is what happened. You know, met Mr. Nathan Kwao, etc. And left it at that, and work was going on. One day, I decided to say hello to them through their office. There was this huge big table in one end of the room. Oh, in front of that huge big table was a tiny little table. And Mr. Nathan Kwao was sitting on that tiny little table in the corner. Oh, Mr. Kwao, what are you doing on this table? And by the way, who's the one using that big, big, big table? It turned out to be that junior person some time ago. You see what I mean? Who went and hey, women some more power. You've gone and brought your senior by far. You've set yourself on this huge table and put the great, excuse me, the great Nathan Kwao on a tiny little table in the corner. I said, no. This won't happen here. Can you believe that Mr. Nathan Kwao would not change the table? He said, oh, it's okay. It's okay. No animosity, no nothing. Mr. Nathan Kwao, it's like his table was big enough for his writing, for things he was doing. That is the humility of this great man. Maybe we should make another time. I wasn't too sure I could make it, but I'm glad I have, okay? Make another time, invite me, and I'll share all the things with you. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you very much for this opportunity.
Former President Jerry John Rawlings there, speaking as the Clocksack Auditorium. And this is where we wrap up today's bulletin of Joy News Today. For more news, log on to myjoyonline.com. My name is Daniel Daze. Keep watching Joy News.